All right, welcome everyone and good morning. Welcome back to Dale's virtual AES booth. I can see a few names I've seen throughout the week, so welcome back. And I see a few that are not, you know, familiar, so welcome to your first session. My name is Eric. I'm Dale's marketing director. And with me, I have Joel Gilbert. He's my colleague at Dale. I'm the marketing person. He's the tech person, as you've probably heard from these other sessions. So he handles all of our systems, speccing, tech support, product evaluation, and everything. So this morning, we have our friends from PreSonus here. PreSonus is the most Louisiana of all companies you'll ever see. You'll rarely find an owner's manual that doesn't have a recipe for Cajun food in the back. I've actually tried to bring those out to, I try to show my bad cooking skills by actually trying some of them.
I got this the other day. I thought it would be amusing.
Gumbo file. Yeah. How unbelievably apropos. So
definitely necessary.
PreSonus covers a really wide range of markets in the professional audio world. They do stuff for live sound. They do stuff for the studio. They do stuff for the home recorder. They do stuff for professionals. They're all over the place and make great offerings for each and every type of market. And we do very well with their mixers, which you may have seen in various catalogs or websites called the StudioLive series. The reason they're called that is because they were meant to be a studio for live originally. It was meant to have multi-track recording of your show or your church service or whatever it may have been, with multi-track recording going straight to a computer where you can do all editing and everything later on. And what happened was it used to have a program called Capture. And all Capture was a simple little free app that was just a multi-track recorder, and you would take those stems and go to your DAW later on and just edit them. So down the road, they've come out with a program called StudioOne, which is a DAW program that really rivals the best of what's out there, whether it's Logic, Cubase, and even Pro Tools. So they have, in more recent generations of the StudioLive, really tried to turn it into not just a live ecosystem, but a studio ecosystem. So we have Joe Gilder here from PreSonus this morning, who's going to show us exactly how they're sort of bringing that live mixer away from the stage and into the studio as a studio ecosystem that rivals their live ecosystem. So without any more of my talking, without further ado, take it away, Joe.
All right, thank you so much. Let me get situated here. All right, so if you want to make my camera full screen, I'm actually going to be switching some different cameras here to show you some different things.
You're in control.
A couple different mixers, a couple different pieces of gear. Yeah.
So if anyone's wondering, at the very top, if you click on View Active Cameras, that's the best way to do that.
There you go. And if it's a little bit cropped, I apologize. The way the GoToMeeting is set up, I think it's going to cut off some of the edges. So we'll just roll with it. But you'll be able to you'll see the center of whatever I'm showing you. So we'll see how that works. So my name is Joe Gilder. I've been working for PreSonus for the last year or so, but I've been using PreSonus products for the last decade or more. PreSonus started off as just a hardware company. And like Eric said, we've moved into software to the point where, you know, we would ship our mixers or our interfaces with some free versions of other people's software so people could have some software to work with. And then eventually we decided, well, let's make our own. And we did, and it just blew up. And it's become that, you know, I switched from Pro Tools to StudioOne years ago. And I've had some form of different pieces of gear I'm going to show you today in my studio as kind of the heart of my studio workflow for years. So I'm not a live sound guy. I use all this equipment specifically in a home studio to do lots of video production, obviously lots of audio and music production, from recording full bands to singer-songwriter stuff, to lots of live streaming and podcasting as well. So everything I'm going to show you today, we're kind of going to go on a journey of kind of mama bear, papa bear, baby bear, like the smallest solution that we have up to the bigger StudioLive mixers. And the focus here will be to show how they integrate with the software, and how they really kind of go hand in hand. So a couple things to keep in mind before we dive in. So StudioOne is our recording software. There's a couple versions of it. StudioOne Prime is our free version. You can get that for free today. Just go to PreSonus.com, and it allows you to check out the software with obviously some limitations to what you can do. But it actually does a lot more than I expected the first time I tried it out. StudioOne Professional is the high-end version. That's what I use in the studio. But then there's a version called StudioOne Artist, which is kind of in between. Full-featured, unlimited tracks, third-party plugin support. But there's a few of the pro features that aren't included in Artist. Now, that software sells normally, the Artist version sells for $100. But when you buy any PreSonus hardware, so whether you're getting like this, I just dropped something, this IO station, which we're going to show in just a second, or any of our interfaces or our mixers, it comes with StudioOne Artist out of the box. So you immediately open the box, install the software, plug in the hardware, and you've got your studio rig ready to go, which to me is just really cool and handy. You're not having to go somewhere else to get the software to do what you want to do with the hardware that you just bought. Okay, so I will leave some time at the end for questions. So if you have questions, write them down or put them in the chat, and I'll answer all those kind of in a batch at the end. But if we're good to go, I'm going to switch cameras here and see how this looks. And we'll go from there. Let's dive in. Okay, this is the adorable yet powerful IO Station 24C. This is a new one. This is a new member of the PreSonus family, and it's really very cool. Now, if you're familiar with PreSonus products, everything to the left of here looks familiar. We have a product called the Fader Port that we've had for years and years. I've used the original Fader Port for a really long time. And then we updated to the version 2, which looks like this. It is a control surface for StudioOne, or really any DAW, where you have a single motorized fader that'll move around with you in the session. I'll show you that in a second. And then all these buttons and transport controls for your DAW. But a lot of people said it'd be great if we could have a Fader Port that also had just a couple of inputs on it, so we could use it as our audio interface as well as a control surface. And we said, okay. So as you can see, if we look at the back of this beauty, we now have two microphone inputs, outputs for your speakers, and outputs for your headphones. Very simple. We didn't go overboard. We wanted this to be a very basic, simple, but useful interface. And as you can see, just in this shot here, I have the bigger StudioLive mixer, which we'll talk about in a second. And I use this in my studio setup as a Fader Port. However, if I need to go do some remote recording where I only need two sets of inputs, I can just take this in my laptop and leave all of this gear at home, and I can get the job done. Couple of cool things about it. It does accept both microphone and line inputs. So as you see, there's a line button here. That means I can take something like a really nice two-channel tube preamp and plug it into this thing and really have a killer sounding system. So you can use your outboard gear. The combo jacks on the back have quarter-inch inputs that allow for a straight-up line input into the system. So you're not limited there. And then obviously 48 volt phantom power on both of the mic inputs. These are our XMAX preamps, the same preamps that we put in our big mixers and all of our audio interfaces. They sound great. That's what you're listening to right now. My voice is going through one of these. Sounds fantastic. And then we have a couple of cool controls down here. Now, it's a small package, right? It's meant to be, sells for $299. It's meant to be a nice, affordable option that gives you a ton of flexibility with inputs and outputs. But we wanted to give you a little bit of extra control over your audio. So aside from having the inputs, we've got the option to listen between your mix, your playback from your DAW, and the inputs on here, as this is a USB device to get zero latency monitoring. Volume control for your headphones, which you would expect. Volume control for the speakers, which is not usually, you wouldn't expect to have that here. And then a mute button for the speakers as well. Now, there are other products that we and others sell that will give you a lot more control over being able to switch speakers and do things like that. But on a compact device like this, having a button to mute the speakers while you're recording is pretty great. Rather than having to always remember to turn the speakers down while I record and then turn them back up when I want to listen back, I can just hit the mute button. That is so handy. And as you can see, we stole it from our bigger StudioLive mixers. So those are the basic bones of what this product is and how it works. But let's dive into StudioOne so you can see it in action. Now, as you can see, there are a lot of buttons on here that can do everything from solo, mute, record, enable, to changing the automation modes, to lots of other things. I'm going to show you my two favorite features here that are incredible, and then everything else is like gravy on top when you get yours. Okay, first thing is this fader here. It is a fully, it's the same fader from our StudioLive mixers. It is a full throw motorized fader. And for a lot of people, as nice as it is to think I want a full console full of faders to adjust when I mix, a lot of times I really only need one at a time. And what's great about the fader on the fader port is it will follow me around the session. So as I click different channels here in Studio One, you can see this fader is jumping to these levels. And if I move a fader while it's selected, if I move it in Studio One, it moves on the IO station. And if I move it on the IO station, it moves in Studio One. These two are linked. That's why they're both moving. It's just super handy. So the workflow for me is, left hand on the fader port or the IO station, right hand on my mouse. So I can come through and say, okay, let's turn that kick down, turn that snare up, turn this hi-hat up, and let's make sure this pad is a little bit louder. So I'm moving with my mouse in my right hand and I'm adjusting the fader with my left hand. It's a killer workflow that I don't have to keep looking down at between the screen and some sort of control surface. I'm literally just looking at the screen, moving my mouse with one hand, keeping my other hand over here ready to go, and I don't have to take my eyes off the screen. That may not seem like a big deal, but it actually saves a ton of time. And it's funny, when I move, if I move houses or switch my studio setup, and this isn't in this exact spot, I'll find myself reaching, and I have to retrain myself to reach for the exact spot where the fader is, because I'm so used to using it without having to look over here to grab the fader. Now, the second thing is even cooler. And this is one, no matter who I show this to, it always gets a big reaction. So let me open up a fat channel plugin here, like this EQ. So this is one of the EQs that comes with Studio One. Now, if I come to this IO station and I come over here and click this link button, all these buttons down here are different modes that have to do with what this knob here does. So this knob here is a rotary knob and also a push button knob. My alarm just went off. And so it does a number of cool things depending on what mode you're in. If you're in pan mode, it controls the panning. If you're in channel mode, it switches between channels. But this is the mode that I use a lot. I'm not sure if you can see it, but it says link. What's happening here is straight magic. When I'm in Studio One, remember I talked about that workflow where I'm using my mouse over here and I've got my hand, my left hand here on the fader port or the IO station, waiting to move the fader. Well, I'm also within reach of this blue knob. Check what happens when I hover my knob over a control or hover my mouse over a control in Studio One in link mode and turn this knob. You see that? I am turning the knob in Studio One, and all I have to do to change different knobs is move my mouse. So I'm moving here, I'm moving here, I'm moving here, I'm moving here. Plus, if I hover over these button controls and turn the knob, it changes which selection is there. If I hover over this power button and press the knob, it turns it on and off. If I hover over this, let's say this low frequency, and I say, you know what, I don't like what I did there, I just want to go back to the default setting, I can just press the knob and it'll go back to its default state. Also works it here in the mixer. I can hover over the panning control and turn the panning, or I can click it to go back to dead center, which is handy at times. If we're connected to an interface, like we are with the Studio Live, where I can control the preamp level, I can hover over that control and turn it up and down. There's just, these are all set to the same input, which is why all those moved at the same time. It is extremely powerful from a let's keep it as simple as we can, but give it as much power as we can standpoint. This thing rocks. Okay, now switching over here to this beautiful blue beauty. This is the middle of the road option of the three options we're going to look at today. If you had asked me, I don't know, 15 years ago, do you need a mixer in the studio? I would have said, no, of course not. You can do everything with a simple audio interface. And that's true. As far as doing any digital things in the studio, an audio interface with just inputs and outputs will absolutely get the job done. However, I have found that I don't know if I can do without a mixer anymore. I've gotten so used to the functionality of plugging in a mic, pushing up a fader, and hearing what's happening, and being able to hear it directly with zero latency and not having to fiddle with software at all, that I could do it if I had to do it with just an interface, but I would much prefer to have a fader so I can push faders up, turn knobs, adjust things, and hear it back instantly with or without software. So that's where I come down. I love mixers. And as you'll see in a minute, my primary brain of my studio is the Studio Live Series 3 mixer, which is kind of our big honking digital, all digital mixer. This StudioLive AR12C is one of three in a series that are seriously underrated mixers in the market. Because if you look at it, if I say, hey, look at this mixer, what do you think? You're thinking it's just like every other analog mixer out there, right? It's got a certain number of inputs, it's got faders, it's got EQs, it's got auxiliary sends, it's got a set of effects, some extra faders here, a master fader, good to go, right? Yawn, let's move on. That's actually not the case. First of all, we've got our XMAX preamps on here. So the preamp you're listening to with my voice right now, I'll say this several times today, is going through an XMAX preamps. They're great sounding pre's. These are the pre's we use on our mixers as well as our studio interfaces. So that's included. But the analog, if you just want to use this as an analog mixer, great, have fun. But that's not really where it starts to shine. It's a wonderful analog mixer. But when you start to incorporate all the digital components, is really where this thing starts to shine. So I don't know if you can see it. If I pull it out just a little bit, you'll see that orange cable there? That is a USB-C cable that is plugged into this MacBook Pro. This is a full-on recording interface, okay? You'll see some mixers out there that have USB outputs that'll just record your stereo mix. That's nice to have, if nothing else. That's not what this is. This will record every input plus your stereo mix. So a total of, I believe we get 16 channels on this mixer into StudioOne. You also, there's a smaller version of this that is an 8-channel version and a larger 16-channel. They all essentially have the same features, just more or less channels depending on what you need. Now, a couple of things that make this cool. First of all, you can multi-track all the inputs, like I said. I can have up to 14 separate inputs going into StudioOne for a multi-track recording platform. So it's great for multi-track recording in the studio, doing a full band recording, or taking it as the live sound mixer for a concert and then multi-tracking that off the board. Second thing that's really cool is this super channel here. You'll notice this channel is different from all of these channels. What makes this one special? Well, it has a crapload of different inputs to give you some different options for playback. So the first thing that's cool is you can have inputs from an RCA or eighth inch stereo jack. So you can plug something from your phone, iPod into these jacks here, turntable. And then here we can play back from USB or from the inserted SD card. That means I can have Spotify or iTunes open on this computer. And as long as that is engaged, when I push this fader up, I'm now hearing playback from the computer. So maybe I'm getting ready for a live stream and I'm testing to make sure all the mics and all the video stuff is working, but I want some background music to play for the 10 minutes before the show starts. That's what this fader is for. Now, Bluetooth. There's Bluetooth on the mixer. On a $600 mixer, you've got Bluetooth enabled. This allows you to just hold down the pair button, grab your phone, I don't have my phone near me, and it'll show up as a Bluetooth device, and you can play music directly from your phone to this channel on the board. What's very cool about this, why we call it the super channel, is all of these inputs can be going simultaneously. So you can be playing backing tracks from StudioOne, but then between sets, if you want to just play some music from your phone, you can play music directly via Bluetooth and you don't have to change inputs here. It's just all there waiting for you. You can even have a backup plugged in to these inputs as well. Very, very cool. And it only takes up one fader as opposed to there's one, two, three, four, technically five sources here, but it's only on one fader. Very good design, if I do say so myself, in my humble yet biased opinion. The next thing that makes this very cool and very useful for studio use is it's an incredible live stream platform. Now, I've been doing YouTube videos for the last decade or more, and I've done tons and tons of live streams, and I don't know if I could do a live stream without some sort of a mixer to allow me to mix my playback from StudioOne, my playback from iTunes, my own vocal, any other vocals of people who might be there or other microphones, whether it's a concert with two mics on a guitar and a mic on the vocal, or somewhere, just an interview where I need two channels up for interviews and a couple channels to play back system audio. This mixer does that really well. And here's one of the big reasons why it's great for podcasting. If you're using a popular dynamic microphone, like an SM7B or the new PD70 from PreSonus, those tend to, as dynamic mics, have a less hot output than a condenser microphone. And these preamps have a decent amount of gain on them, but we realized that we might want a little extra juice for those dynamic mics. That's why on this mixer, if I zoom in, you'll see right here, there's a plus 10 dB switch on several of the channels. This allows me to add 10 decibels of extra gain to the channels that have those lower output microphones, which is really, really handy. And it's a nice clean boost. It just gives you more signal, no extra noise. Another cool thing, this will record all the channels into your DAW, and it will play back two pairs of channels down these two faders. I already mentioned you can play back your playback from iTunes here, maybe for reference tracks, and then you can have your playback from StudioOne coming here. Or you could have StudioOne playing back here and have your click track playing back on this channel. You can see there's a 3-4 button there with a USB symbol right here. That allows me to turn this channel into a digital return from the computer. Now, you're not going to be able to play back all 24 or 16 tracks from your DAW through this. Again, this is mainly designed for capturing on the front end, multi-track recording, but with some added flexibility on playback, so you have more than just a single pair of outputs coming to the mixer. Oh, and I got confused there. I mentioned live streaming, but then I started talking about podcasting. This is great for live streaming because of this little button right here. I don't know if you can see it very well, but it says USB send 1 and 2. And when I push it, it lights up. Here's a common problem people face when doing live streaming. They've got all their, let's say they want to live stream a concert, right? You're going to sit down, you and one other person, you got maybe stereo mics on the guitar and 2 vocals, right? You get your mix, you get everything sounding great. And then you go to do your live stream and you open up, let's say it's YouTube, and it says, what's your audio source? And you say, oh, my audio source is the AR-12C. And it sees it, you see that there's audio, and you say, great, here we go. And you do your whole live stream show. What's the problem? A lot of times those software, when you're just going streaming straight to YouTube, you tell it to listen to AR-12C, and it is, but it's actually only listening to channels 1 and 2. That's just how it's set up a lot of times. So if it's only listening to channels 1 and 2, if we had our guitar on 3 and 4 and vocals on 1 and 2, guess what? Your entire live stream is just vocals. All that work you did to set this up and make it sound good, especially if you had more tracks, all these channels are set up, they're only hearing these two because the digital system is really only expecting a 2-channel audio interface. That's a problem. Now, there's software you can buy to help fix that problem, but we decided to solve that problem for you directly on the mixer with this button right here. So as soon as I hit USB 1 and 2, USB send 1 and 2, and I turn that on, it now, instead of the computer hearing these two channels as channels 1 and 2, it hears the entire mix. So it takes what's running through this main output, this master fader, is now what feeds channels 1 and 2 into whatever software you're using. So you don't need an extra piece of software to do the routing internally, which is what I've had to use for years. You just go boink, and now you're off to the races and good to go. And added benefit, you know, this meter here will correspond to what you're sending to the digital system there. This is a killer setup. If you're thinking, I want some more hands-on control on the recording end, but maybe you don't have the budget to spend the kind of money that it would cost to get the big StudioLive mixer, which we're going to look at next, this is a great solution. And to answer a couple of questions, these are normal faders. They're not motorized. They don't move around. This is not a control surface. This is an analog mixer with a bunch of great digital features strapped onto it to make it way more useful than just literally pulling in an analog mixer here and trying to make that work in your studio. You need some of these digital functionality. And final piece of the puzzle, there is the ability to record your stereo mix to an SD card. So if you take this out on the road and you want to just record the stereo mix, you can do that here. But really, instead of giving you multi-track recording on an SD card, which turns this into a standalone multi-track recorder, which is really not what most people are after. They want something that will give them lots of inputs into their system, which is why we designed it the way we did. And remember, this comes with StudioOne Artist. So right out of the box, you get this, you register it, you download StudioOne Artist, and you've got full-on multi-track recording, unlimited tracks, third-party plugin support right out of the box. This is a great, great mixer and well worth your time to look at and see if it makes sense for you and your studio. And now we've moved on to the big mamma jamma, the StudioLive Series 3 mixers. I've been a StudioLive user since the original 24-channel StudioLive. That's actually what this desk was built for. And then I upgraded to the Series 3 when that came out. And these are incredible mixers, and they've got a lot of power packed into them just from a live mixing standpoint. A digital mixer that has so many features that much more expensive mixers have, but at a much more affordable price point. These range anywhere from The low 2000 price point up to $39.99 for the bigger decked out one with 64 inputs. So what do you get with these? By the way, this is this 24, StudioLive 24. We actually don't make this one anymore. We now make the smallest one you can get is the same form factor, but actually has 32 mic inputs, which is incredible. But everything else I'm going to show you is pretty much the same. So what do you get with this as opposed to the ARC mixers that I've shown you? This is a full-on digital system that gives you all the benefits of a digital mixer, but still maintains a simplicity that a lot of folks find to be really helpful. Sometimes digital mixers get a bad rap for being unnecessarily complicated, and the StudioLive balances that line of lots of great features, and you can really go in depth with it without having to get super, super complicated. You can sit down, and without the manual, you can pretty much figure out how this thing works if you understand digital audio and digital mixing. One of the biggest changes, of course, is the faders are motorized now. So we can switch through all these different mixes and the faders will move all by themselves. We can bank between, right now we're seeing 24 channels of input. We can bank over to see the rest, and those all move on their own. That's really fun. I mean, honestly, when people come over and say, oh, that's such a cool mixer, I'm like, oh, just wait till you see this. I put it into Mardi Gras mode. This serves absolutely zero function from a audio standpoint, but it sure is fun to watch. And it lets you make sure all the faders are working too, and all the lights and all the buttons. So let's talk about now specifically this. The whole point of today was to show you the hardware, but specifically how it integrates with software. So I've got a StudioOne session pulled up. And this session has, it's not a huge session. Okay. It has 35 audio tracks. You can see this is kind of everything that's included. The bulk of it is there's a couple of loop sounds up here, some background vocal loops, drums, bass. Here, blue are the guitars, green's acoustic guitar. There's a pad track, vocal, and some background, other background vocals. So it's not huge. It's not like there's a ton going on here. But what's great about the StudioLive is we can use it from the front end standpoint as a tracking device. And that's one of the biggest reasons why I like having a mixer in my studio is it allows me to get lots of inputs on one device. So I have on this exact mixer, I've recorded the biggest session I've done has been drums, bass, and also keyboards and acoustic guitar or electric guitar. Well, I guess electric guitar. And so I've taken up probably 16 or more channels on the mixer simultaneously. And what's great is I can record all of those into StudioOne. This has a USB connection on it that plugs into my computer, and I can track all of those into StudioOne. I can even play them all back through the mixer if I want to, because the one big difference between this and the ARC mixer is this has as many outputs as it does inputs. So I can run, you know, 32 channels into my DAW, and I could play back 32 channels through the mixer if I wanted to. But the other big thing is I can monitor everything as we're doing a tracking session. Everyone's listening to themselves off the board, so I don't have to worry about setting up headphone mixes inside of StudioOne. I can set them up here using these different submixes over here. So this is the drummer's mix, set the faders. This is the bass player's mix, set the faders, and we can switch back between them and easily change them and do all of this without having to touch the software almost at all, which is just, to me, is just incredible. So if we switch back over here to the main mix, we can then kind of control what we're hearing in the control room, and then we can have the band hearing their own thing. Very, very cool. And all of that without having to, we could do all that without even opening the recording software. So we can get all the headphone mixes, set the levels, get everything sounding great, and then fire up StudioOne and start actually recording, which is really fun. The computer ends up being just a multi-track recording digital system versus having to wear lots of different hats. There's no problem with working the other way. If you use something like our Quantum interface, then you would do all your headphone routing and mixes inside of StudioOne, and it can do that wonderfully. But it's really nice to be able to just put your hands on faders and make things move. Now, what happens after you get things recorded? Okay, once it's all in StudioOne, what's the use of this big mixer with all these features? Well, you know what, before I get into that really quickly, one extra thing that I forgot to mention is on this mixer, the other mixer I showed you has EQ on each channel, and that's really it. That's what to kind of keep the price down and to keep it simple, it's got EQ. These, however, on every one of our mic, our input channels, we've got access to a high pass filter, preamp, a gate, a compressor, and we can switch between several, let me switch over here. We can switch between several different types of compressors on the mixer itself. So we're running compressor plugins on the mixer. So we can run this tube compressor or this FET compressor on all of our channels. And we can have this be recorded into StudioOne if we want, or it can just be something that we listen to as we're tracking, but we record a clean track. That's all done by just setting it on a per track basis. And this is our, this is called our FAT channel. So it comes with compressors and also different EQs that allow us to dial in and shape the tone using really great sounding plugins that are also available in StudioOne, and we can use them here on the way in. So now, what about once we've recorded? How does this mixer help us when it comes to the mixing side of things? Do we run all our channels through this and mix through the mixer? You can. I've done that. It's great. I don't love that workflow as much as I love this button here. And this is why a lot of people get into this mixer. I'm a big fan of owning gear that wears lots of hats. So this is a ton of inputs for me to track through. It gives me low latency monitoring. Okay. It's an interface, it's a mixer all in one. But then when all that's done, it is now a control surface. If I press this DAW mode button, look what just happened. All the faders moved. What can you tell what happened here? This is no longer a mixer. The mixer is still activated. You can still hear my voice, which is running through the mixer. It's running through channel 3 here. So here's my voice. But I switched to DAW mode, everything changed. The entire mixer changed. And look what happens as I move faders here on the mixer. If we look on the screen here, as I move these faders, we are now controlling StudioOne as a control service. We have access to all the faders, move the faders, which you would expect. The solo buttons do soloing, mute does mute. We can even select channels and they'll pop up here on the screen on the StudioLive and tell us what's happening on that channel. So we can do other things. We can record enable a channel. We can adjust the panning here by tapping that and turning maybe we can't do that here. And then we can pull up plugins. So if I see there's two FAT channel plugins on this channel, I can tap them each here and then see what's happening on the screen. So you can kind of decide how much of a workflow, hands-on workflow you want when it comes to working in StudioOne. You also have transport control. So I can hit play and we can start playing this song. Moving all those faders just totally jacked up that mix. But you get the idea. We can hit play, we can hit record, we can rewind. We can also open up the plugins and show them. And even the controls for the plugins get mapped out across these encoders here. So you have lots of options. If you want to just completely like turn the screen off and work from the mixer, you can. Or what I like to do is do some sort of a hybrid approach where I'm checking things here. I use it early in the mix to set my levels, because I can flip between all the channels. I don't have to look at the screen at all. I can see this is the acoustic guitar. Let's turn that up. I can press this mix effects master button and it pulls up all my main buses. So my drums bus, my electric guitar bus, my bass bus, and I can just adjust those if I want and have those on this group of faders while all the individual channels are on these groups of faders. So I can do my static mix and get levels and panning done really quite easily. And then I can start adding in plugins. So I like to do a little bit of both. I'll have my hand on the mouse here. I can tap things to bring it up and then I can adjust it with the mouse. Or if you want to get real nerdy and start to kind of put it all together, I can adjust things with the mouse. I can get the mix here on the StudioLive. I can pull up a channel here and then I can use that link mode from the fader port to control each of these knobs if I want. Lots of flexibility and each of these kind of has their own purpose. By the way, I didn't mention this at the beginning, but this is our Atom, which is a production controller, MIDI controller with pads and a bunch of controls on it. It is completely separate. The StudioLive has a tray here for iPads, which give you some added functionality, or just as it turns out, the Atom fits really, really well right there. So that's kind of the big picture overview of the StudioLive. It does a lot of extra things, like you can pair your phone to Bluetooth to play on a channel. You can do all sorts of cool routing because you have all of these submixes here. Just as an example, when I turn DAW mode off, right now you're hearing my voice. So I'll give you kind of walk you through the signal flow so you can kind of see what's happening. My voice is coming on this channel, okay? That channel is going out my main mix. I've got that main mix routed to mix 1 and 2, which is what I have set as my input for my video recording software in my computer. So I can have a separate mix. Actually, right now, as I'm sitting here in my studio, you can hear my voice, but I can't. Can you think about why that would be important? Well, because if my voice is coming out of my speakers, I'm going to have feedback. So I need to hear the playback from StudioOne, but I don't need to hear my own voice here out of the speakers. And I'm able to do that with the different routing options available here. The way I do that here is I actually solo the things I want to hear, which are the playback from StudioOne and a couple of other inputs in the mixer, but leave my voice unsoloed so that what I'm hearing out of the monitor bus is what's soloed, but what you're hearing is actually what's being routed on the main mix to inputs one and two into my computer. Now, I know that that's a little confusing, and I could probably go over that a couple of times to make it clear, but hopefully you can, if you understand kind of the basic routing options on most audio interfaces, you can't do this on a regular audio interface, but the fact that this is a digital mixer, we can do that 8 times with 8 different stereo mixes or 16 different mono mixes and get really creative with the different routing that we can do. In addition, if you look on the back of this, obviously I can't lift this up to show it to you, but it has an Ethernet port there. That's two, actually. One of them is what I'm using to do DAW control. So to do DAW mode, to do the control surface functionality, I plug an Ethernet port from the control port back here. You can maybe see the port right there into my computer, and that links things up. You can see here, if I come over to out of DAW mode and hit this UC net control, you can see it sees my iMac and it's doing transport control. However, there's also another Ethernet port on the back of these mixers that supports AVB, which is a digital audio protocol you might have heard of, that allows me to connect more than one of these mixers or connect this mixer to a stage box that's 300 feet away and use that for inputs into this system and then route outputs from this system to that stage box to plug into wedge monitors and speakers and in-ear systems and things like that. So while I'm only showing you the functionality for StudioOne, and I primarily only use this mixer for a studio environment, I've used these mixers, not this exact one, but other StudioLive mixers, both the rack mount and the regular setup ones, to do live sound, and they're killer for that. That's why they're called StudioLive. They're really built for live, but as it turns out, they are killer for studio use as well. And there's so much more that I could show you, but that kind of gives you the idea. If you just look at the mixer, if you go pull up the 3 or 4 versions on your favorite retailer, and you'll see just take a look at the images, or look on the PreSonus website, look at the images for the StudioLive, and you can learn a lot about what this can do just by looking at the back panel, how many inputs and outputs you have, because it's a bunch, and then all the controls that you have available here. And you start to realize, man, I could do this, I could do that, I could do this. And then there's a bunch of kind of hidden features that you discover once you own it and start working with it. Like, for example, these controls can be mapped to kind of anything you want. Mute groups, these can be mapped to literally to specific macros inside of StudioOne, where I press one, it triggers a chain of commands inside of StudioOne. Lots and lots of different options, which make the StudioLive such a great piece, centerpiece for any studio. Okay. All right. So we switch back over here. Sorry if that was kind of cropped down. I think the GoToMeeting platform would rather have a 720. Than a 1080, which is what all my cameras are set to. So next time we'll all that down. But yeah, if you have any questions on really anything we talked about there, I'm happy to answer those. Or Eric, let me know what needs to happen next. But yeah, thank you for being here and hanging out. This is AES 2020, man. Let's do it at home style.
If anyone does have any questions, feel free to unmute yourself or put it in the chat. I can read it to you. I can also read off of the I can in my AES chat as well, so you can get me there. Cool. Yeah, anyone has any questions, please fire away.
I got a quick question.
Sure.
About the what communication protocol is being spoken between the mixer and StudioOne, or is it a proprietary thing?
Well, we do support AVB, which is its own separate protocol that we didn't develop, but we use. But that's mostly for connecting multiple devices. So stage boxes and the little personal mixer thing that we have and things like that. As far as it's going USB into the computer, so it's mostly class compliant as far as just the audio streams. But it works with any DAW. It'll show up like a regular interface, just a regular, you know, whatever, 32 channel audio interface. With StudioOne, there's a few extra goodies you may have seen in that screenshot. I can control the preamp gain from StudioOne at the top of the channel. It shows up there. So there's a few of those things that I can do, control the hardware from the software that's specific to StudioOne because we made both. But otherwise, there's plenty of folks that use these with Pro Tools, Logic, things like that, and it works just fine. You lose a couple of those control things, but those are kind of little added bonuses that don't make a huge difference either way.
All right, cool. Thanks.
All right, any questions from any of the attendees?
Attendee number 19, you're up.
You're up.
Great name. Oh, now you're not up. I think you muted yourself. You were there. I had you for a second.
There you go. You're up.
We can Who's 19?
You are. You know, you are.
Me. How do I know my number? Sorry. Okay. We have new Axia consoles, and I understand we could connect PreSonus console to our Axia. Is that right?
I'm not familiar with those. What's the protocol there?
It's LiveWire.
We use AVB as far as digital connection, and we just recently came out with a Dante, an extra box that'll convert the AVB to Dante, so then you can integrate with a lot of Dante systems. But I'm not familiar with those specific mixers.
LiveWire extension, it can talk to other protocols via the AES 67.
Yeah.
My advice to you is contact my colleague, Joel. Joel will put his email address into the chat. We'd like to hear about what you're doing, and maybe we can try and point you in the right direction. I can speak up for Joe only because we do so much broadcast at Dale. I can speak up on Joe's behalf and tell you that they will not talk to one another because they're using different audio network protocols. But yes, Joel, my colleague, just put his email into the chat if you want to copy it down. Please reach out to us. We'll help get it. Whatever you're doing, we'll help you. We'll get from point A to point B.
However, okay, that's great.
We'll be happy to help.
Yeah, it's probably a it would be a AVB to AES 67 conversion.
One way
at some point. And there's various devices to do that. It just depends on how many channels you want to go and you want to go bi-directionally.
But I'm not sure. What we did was put in small radio the Fusion, Axia's Fusion consoles, so mm-hmm. there's not that many faders, but we have a room where we could put at least 16 microphones in it for recording music, and we have done that in the past, but okay. We didn't want to do that immediately, but we know that we could probably connect some other console to our Axia system, and this could work pretty well, you know, if there's the right kind of protocols or... I'm not sure how the conversion would work, so we'll have to hear about it.
Okay, for sure. Yeah, like I said, my email address is in the chat. Just send me a note. I'll give you some ideas of conversion boxes, and then it'd be good to have a console in that room, and then you could also do a quick stereo recording, or record to the SD card as backup in the console as well.
Right. Oh, are there any consoles that use the LiveWire that we could?
LiveWire is outside the Telos ecosystem. There's a company called Yellowtech that makes a small, but it's more radio oriented. But LiveWire is very similar to what's called AES 67. Mm-hmm. And there are more, there's more AES 67 devices. AES 67 can be compatible with Dante, which is a very widely used format, but it's not 100% guaranteed to.
Right.
So you just need to make sure that it's best to have some sort of device doing the translation rather than software, because that's just less reliable.
Okay, thanks a lot.
All right, no problem. Well, shoot me an email and we can definitely figure something out.
Okay. Yep.
Sounds like that's an internet radio station or something? Or
no, we're WHYY in Philadelphia. We do Fresh Air.
Okay.
We needed to update our consoles. We had analog PR&E since 1999, and they were great. I'm glad we went with analog then, but it was really time for digital. And
radio then.
we did it right on time because in February we put in some Axia, and then some of our combo hosts were able to stay home because of COVID and connect. So
wow. That's really no, fortunate.
All right, so nice you're timing. Terrestrial radio.
Yeah, we are.
Cool. Yeah, no, I saw you guys pop up earlier in the week in our sign up section, and just so you know, you do have an existing account with us, so we'll take that offline after the session, though, Joel.
Okay.
Great.
I'll make
sure. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Right, did you leave your contact? Were you the one who signed up in the earlier in
the?
Okay, great.
I believe it was me.
We'll make sure we add you to the account because I just brought up your account and you're not there. So we'll make sure that you're added in. We'll introduce you to the salesperson who handles your station, but you're all set.
Okay, thanks a lot.
Get that going for you. Anyone else? Go ahead, Vaibhav, you're up.
Yeah. Hi. By the way, hi guys. I'm Vaibhav from I'm from India, and Joe, I've been watching your show for years, and I'm a big fan.
That's awesome.
So I'm like a little fan going right now. Yeah. So I had a question about the ARC mixers. So you mentioned live streaming, right? So when you press the the USB out 1 and 2 button on the mix bus, what happens on the other channels when you because someone like me who would like to record the multi-track live stream from it as well, so is that still an option?
So you want to know if you can record the multi-tracks and also have a live stream mix?
Yes.
Is that the question? Okay. Yeah, there's two ways to do it.
Yeah.
The stock interface, the way it works, on this one, I believe it still records. If you were to record all the channels, it'll record channels 1 through 16, and then there's a channels 17, 18 that's your main mix. So that's already built in. The problem is when you get into situations where the software is only looking at channels 1 and 2, then you can flip over to that USB 1-2 system. And when you do that, it does kill channels 1 and 2 for recording. So if you had a mic and a guitar in channels 1 and 2, those wouldn't be able to be multi-tracked because it would flip that input to something else. So if you're filling up the board, then you'll want to use that extra stereo pair as your mix. Otherwise, just leave channels 1 and 2 empty if you're going to use that send back in. If you want to multi-track, if you're just using it and you just want to send the main mix, you can have something on every channel and it'll work flawlessly. But that's kind of the little catch there.
Yeah, that's great. Amazing. Thanks.
Yeah.
Excellent.
Thank you.
I think, someone, and just to tag on to that, Joe, can you also stream a track off of your computer and stream a board mix at the same time?
Yes. That particular mixer has that super channel I talked about. It's a USB return channel. So it's channels 1 and 2 coming from the computer. And then there's an extra button you can press on the adjacent stereo channel to turn it into a digital return for channels 3 and 4. So you could have basically two stereo mixes coming back from your computer that you can blend in with the other channels as you go. You lose that analog channel, obviously, when you switch it to the digital return, but you can have, for example, a click track on one fader, the rest of the playback on the other, and then all your analog channels for the stuff you're playing live.
All right. Gray, I think I saw you activate for a brief moment.
Yeah, for a brief moment. So I think you guys have pretty much sold me on the IO station. I'd love to integrate them into my workflow. So you guys have pickup in Jamaica?
Yes. Yes, we do.
Okay. Cool.
In fact, I just saw your email pop up in my thing, so we'll shoot you out something right after this session.
Okay, great.
It's just so cute, isn't it? Yeah, I love it.
Excellent.
Is there anyone else? Any other questions? Okay, so now we have to get the big reveal of what the mystery gift is that PreSonus has been nice to bestow upon us. As you can probably see through the chat, Joel has been posting a link to our raffle site. So the big mystery gift, courtesy of Joe's boss, that he has bestowed upon us. So Joe, I'm going to ask you to just give a quick overview.
Sure.
One of you, after the show, is going to win a one-year subscription to PreSonus Sphere. So,
yes.
Joe, you want to give a quick overview of what that is? And what
yeah, this is
basically an everything, it's like everything PreSonus for a year.
Yeah, it's kind of our everything bundle. So thank you for bringing that up because I forgot to mention it. So we launched back in July with version 5 of StudioOne that came out, PreSonus Sphere, which is a subscription membership platform that gets you access to StudioOne Professional, also Notion. We own Notion, the notation software. And for the last, 10 years, we've been adding different add-ons and bonus software that you can add to StudioOne within the PreSonus shop. So some really cool analog emulations of compressors and EQs, a bunch of samples, some great orchestral symphonic stuff, some great piano samples, things like that. And historically, those have been just things you kind of pick and choose and order a la carte. This PreSonus Sphere subscription gets you access to all of that, kind of one big, huge, it'll take you forever to sift through all of it, but a lot of good stuff to mess with. So yeah, we're giving away a full year subscription to that to one lucky person.
Cool. So just make sure you enter. Joel put the link to what Sphere is. There's also a link where it says enter to win. It's a bit.ly link. If you haven't done so already during the course of this session, please just go in and enter for it. Yeah, you'll get a 1 year. It's $165 value. So definitely worth it. Anyone else? Because we're just about to hit our time. No? All right. Well, I will then wrap things up here. So we want to thank once again PreSonus.
Thank you very much, Joe.
Thank you to Joe.
It's been a blast.
Time today. Thanks to Joe's boss, Rick Nackvi, for the kind gift to the attendee, which we'll dole out after the session's over. We have a couple more sessions throughout the day, so if you guys want to come back to our portal, we're doing a farewell event to our senior-most salesperson who's retiring, and then we're doing a cool giveaway with another vendor later on in the day. So please come back. We are going to archive all these on our social media channels after the show because we're recording them all. So if you missed anything or you came in late, you can always come back and look again. So thank you to Joe. Thanks to PreSonus. And we'll see you guys next time.
Have a good rest of your last day of virtual AES.
Thanks, Eric. Thanks, Joel.